if this is not possible, what is possible? You know, to allow warships, research vessels, and all that to come into Sri Lankan ports, and then allow them to use their capability to eavesdrop on a friend. India is a friend of Sri Lanka. So how can Sri Lanka allow another adversary of India to come there and carry on with this kind of spying activities?
Commodore Vasan, how concerned is India with regard to the Chinese naval ship?
Any development in the neighborhood is a matter that will be factored. So will it be a matter of concern or not is something that the planners will definitely know. Like today, you know, I think I said that in one of your interviews earlier, that Sri Lanka, the Humber that I included, is within the range of India's power and influence, you know, including military power. So, you know, while it's not something that is being stated to, indicate that India will carry out any attacks or whatever, in future, if China uses that as a military port, then we have every right to take on any threat that is likely to emerge from Humber. So, not against Sri Lanka, but against China, which may misuse the facility provided by Sri Lanka for a commercial option, which is also to repay the debts which were there. So we understand the precarious position in which Sri Lanka was, which compelled them to give away Humber Tota. But India is capable of taking very independent actions against anyone who has ill designs in our neighborhood. It's from that point of view that I am saying that we must express our concerns. The concerns are not to say that, you know, we are helpless. Concerns are to say that we are allowing a situation to develop in our neighborhood, which may have implications for our future relationships. It's very simple as all that. Not that India is not capable of taking on anyone in the Indian Ocean region, because we have that one of the largest navies in the region, and we have the capability for surveillance and for interdiction. And also China, which has many of thousands of ships which are transiting through the sea lanes of communication, knows very well that it is vulnerable in the Indian Ocean region when it comes to the kind of might that Indian Navy can bring to the table. So it is not that, but if something happens, if I keep quiet, it will only encourage China to bring in, instead of one research vessel, let's say 3 or 4 ships tomorrow. It might now tomorrow say, no, India has not responded, let's take the complete fleet there. So we are trying to tell them that, look, you know, we know what you are doing. You know, Indian Navy today has the capability to monitor the entire Indian Ocean region through what we call the Maritime Domain Awareness Program. And therefore, we know what is happening. We have tracked their submarines, we have tracked their ships, we have tracked their merchant shipping. So we are not unduly concerned about not knowing whether. But we are trying to tell both our friends and our adversaries, we know where we are, we know where you are. So, you know, it is a question of signaling the capability of Indian Navy to say, look, we are prepared. You know, so don't take us for granted. So, you know, therefore, it also puts a certain amount of counter pressure on China, which says, well, you know, we've been monitored. You know what they're doing, you know, including those nuclear submarines, we are monitored. So there is nothing unusual about this kind of game that goes on in the Indian Ocean region. But knowing where they are and knowing that Sri Lanka is perhaps helpless and is not able to stop those ships from coming to Humber Tota. If you have already given away Humber Tota for nearly 100 years, how can you stop them from coming? They exercise the full control. So we understand the helplessness of Sri Lanka, but we need to convey a stern message to say that we understand what is happening, but try and see how we can stop this. Technically, there is nothing wrong. Any ship can come, any ship can be refueled, any ship can be given provisions. Technically, there is nothing wrong in even a warship being there. But what is the time that China has chosen? Why are you here? You know, was it so inevitable that you must come here? Or is it also to such a kind of signaling from the PLA Navy to the Indian Ocean region countries to say that, look, this is my support? It's also demonstrating its capability and saying that, you know, look, I have this kind of assets.
Commodore Vasan, I actually yesterday I watched a television program, Indian TV, Professor Kondapalli from JNU said, this ship is a massive ship and is a half the size of an aircraft carrier. And inside this ship, what kind of tools are there? What exactly they can do?
No, see, it's very clear that it's not the first ship. It's quite an old ship, actually. It's been there in existence for quite some time. And normally, these kind of ships with that kind of hull can go on for 30 years. And also, they will get what's called a midlife upgrade. That means every 5 years or 10 years, they'll keep changing their equipment. You know, it's like an upgradation program that would have taken place. And so, the basic purpose is to monitor the activities related to missile launches. So, if tomorrow you are launching, let's say, something from Sriharikota, if they are positioned anywhere here, you know, it is in the position to track the entire trajectory of the missile. Let's say we test out, you know, we put out notices to say that they're carrying out the launch of the PSLV or any other missile or FB missile, anything. So these can be tracked. Once you know the trajectory, so by analysis, you can make out what kind of height it achieves, what is the entry parameters of that, what kind of payloads are carried. So all these are put together. All these are put together to you know, to build up a database, and they can thereafter have the counters. So, you know, which is why the size, the ship, you know, as rightly brought out, is half the size of the carrier that we are going to launch, will have the ability to carry phenomenal amount of equipment. You know, so the, according to the reports, they've said up to 750 kilometers, you know, of airspace can be monitored. What it means is it has radars, it has passive array systems, which can look at the entire picture, both the surface picture and the air picture, and, you know, take this data, record it, analyze it, and thereafter, they know what kind of capability the target nation has in terms of its space assets, in terms of its missile capability, in terms of its counters that it can bring to the table. So this is the way that the entire envelope is established. So which is why the fact that a research vessel as capable as this one is here in our depot is a matter that we take seriously.
Commodore Watson, when you take the entire naval capacity of the countries, major countries, where is currently China ranked when it comes to naval capacity?
No, China has already overtaken USA in terms of sheer numbers. But as all of us know, mere numbers do not make a navy. You know, in terms of quality of the ship, while they have very modern ships today, they are still not a match for USA. USA today has more than a dozen nuclear capable ships, you know, each with capacity for 95,000 tons and carrying multiple squadrons and a cattle carrier battle group, you know, which can go to the far corners of the world. China does not have that capability today, still. Also, the fact that it is not geographically so well positioned in comparison with India makes its task difficult. No, I have always used this word called tyranny of distance. You know, because from there, if it has to come all the way, let's say, to be deployed in the Indian Ocean region, it has to sail its ships from South China Sea to cross the Western Pacific through the Straits of Malacca right into the Indian Ocean region after passing the scrutiny of Indian Navy. I'm not talking about Andaman Nicobar Islands. So we have assets there. So from there, you can monitor the entire deployment pattern of these vessels. So mere numbers, coming back to your question, is not an indication that it is superior. Something like 30 to 40% of its assets have no choice but to remain in South China Sea because they have disputes with all the Southeast Asian neighbors. You know, something like 6 to 7 of them have EEZ overlapping issues. And it has also converted many of the rocks and reefs into islands where it is being used as a military asset. So, you know, this is where I come back to the point to say that while they are also improving in, you know, enhancing the quality of their navy, they are nowhere yet near the capacity and capability of US Navy, which has been leading for decades and has the capacity to deployed such globally. That capacity is not yet there, while I'm sure China is aiming to be there. They just recently commissioned their third aircraft carrier. So they'll have to catch up with USA by building a similar kind of carrier battle group. Carrier battle group is not just the carrier group. You know, the carrier battle group is a complete system, you know, which has submarine ships, advanced warning aircraft, you know, satellite connectivity. So it is not that, you know, China has suddenly become number one navy. I would not say that it has become number one navy. Yes, in terms of numbers, it has surpassed the total number that US Navy has. It is ahead of us in numbers, but because of the geographical limitations which I discussed earlier, it is not in a position to deploy all its assets globally as US Navy would. So that is a point that must not be forgotten.
Commodore Vasan, as you know, because of the political crisis in Sri Lanka, still we don't have an established government. You know, although we have a new president, still there is a discussion going on of all party setting up an all party government. And so amid all this situation, you know, like you know, so do you think that China strategically submit their request to berth the ship in the Hambantota port?
No, it's like this. You know, I already indicated about the kind of helplessness that Sri Lanka, I know, has demonstrated because of cumulative impact of what happened since last 6-7 months, or even more for that matter. The point is here, today there is another narrative to say that, you know, so in the process of the ship being berthed there, Sri Lanka will get some money, you know, in terms of berthing. I don't know what the arrangements are in Hambantota, how much of money will come to Sri Lanka if the Hambantota is already under the control of China. People are trying to tell us that, they will also get some money for the fuel. How will you sell fuel when you yourself do not have fuel? How much fuel will you give to this ship? So, you know, a lot of this are, you know, being imagined to construct a different narrative and to say that, no, we are also gaining from this visit of the ship. I don't agree with this, because if Hambantota is fully operated by CHMP, you know, China Harbour, whatever company that there is, and if they are bringing there, all that perhaps you will get paid for is the fuel that may come from one of the fuel companies there. But where is that fuel? You yourself have a serious issue on fuel. The fuel itself is a scarce commodity. So when you have scarce commodity, what is the kind of foreign exchange that you earn through this transaction? In fact, some of this may be adjusted against the loan that you still owe to China. So this is a serious situation for Sri Lanka going, and to justify and say that we'll also likely to make some money is something which I don't buy.
Yesterday I watched the Indian television discussion program, and one professor from JNU, Kondapali, he was telling that this is an attempt by the China in the future to militarize the Hambantota. Are you sharing the same sentiment?
That any port or facility which has a dual use is of concern. So in the case of Hambantota, though it is now a commercial port, the point is that the same port can provide a whole lot of support, ranging from fuel, food, military ammunition, etc., to any country. So it is from that point of view that we are looking at Hambantota as perhaps a potential dual use port, which can also be militarized as required by China. So is it a military port today? It is not. However, in the future, as and when the situation demands that, you know, China deploys its war vessels from the PLA Navy, it will have an option not only in Hambantota but also in Djibouti. Djibouti is a stated military base, whereas Hambantota is not. So, but the point that Hambantota can be converted into a military base is something that is had to be factored in our calculations, because your Matala airport, which is close to Hambantota, will allow China to have an air bridge all the way from China to Hampantur, to Matala. So the shields and military supplies can be brought to Hampantur. So these are the factors that would have been considered by the Indian planners here. But the fact that it is happening here obviously has raised a lot of concerns in both the political and military establishment.